It is so extremely important that if you're not in this class at this very moment, All right. The subtitle that I have for this answers it all, and that is Faith in the God of the Cross. Faith in the God of the Cross. So if you're going to talk about faith in God, I don't know about other gods, but there is a God of the Cross, okay? There is a crucified God. Okay. All right, so let me just read a little bit here. There is a specific faith that God wants. All right. Now, I mean, that's a pretty powerful statement. There's a specific faith that God wants. For God, faith is specific in that it is pointed to the cross. It is pointed to the cross. Therefore, faith in Jesus is specific because it is not just a belief that there was such a person, meaning Jesus existed, but joins that person to an action which took place at the cross. Okay? This is so important, and I tried to use those a few words there to try to really shake it up, because I think in the minds of a lot of Christians, there is this big eternal reality called God that was before time and is after time, and it's just God, in the beginning, God. And so that's just the big one. But at a certain juncture in time, God became man, and he came down here, and he was kind of hid for like 30 years, but in 3.5 years, he ministered, and he did a lot of big stuff, and then a lot of people will believe in that Jesus of Nazareth. But then he died on the cross, but then he rose again and he went back to being the big, just God in general. And that's the one you're supposed to believe in. And not that I'm anybody that I can say anything, but my belief is that the cross was God's attempt to show what he was really like in nature. That the cross was not an event. That the cross as an event, maybe, yes, it took care of sins and this and that, but there was a more eternal purpose. Eternal meaning without beginning and without end. Sin started, so that's not an eternal purpose to remedy sin. So it was his desire to make himself known. He is, and I don't even remember which class. It might have even been the black hole one, whatever. But I started one of those classes, and I really went over this reality of him being the God of the cross. And that out of all the gods, he's the only one who is the God of the cross. And his one symbol that identifies him anywhere is the crucifix. And that he's known by that. He's not known by the resurrection. We don't wear little tombs with a little slid door open and stuff and go, resurrection, yeah. You know, it's all about resurrection. No. It's about him in his self-giving nature. And that's the reality that is him. And if somehow that thing captured you so deeply that was your identification of just God if he never died for your sins, your faith would be in the God of the cross or the God of self-giving. All right. Now, the reality is that this God of the cross, it covers everything from sins to the whole gamut. Okay, it covers all of that, but he's the God of the cross that made it happen. Okay? Faith in Jesus is connected to faith in his death, right? Right? I mean, you take the cross out of this, what do you have? You know, you're still in your sins, okay? So faith in Jesus is connected to faith in his death, which in this case involves faith in a certain kind of death. Now, we're not just talking about a crucifix or a, you know, two pieces of wood. We're talking about a selfless kind of death. It was the only death like it that had ever existed. Right? No one else had really selflessly given themselves, because all men were selfish until the cross, until we were born again. And even born again people are selfish unless the God of the cross becomes the government of the heart of that particular believer. Okay? So a certain kind of death. Now you're gonna hear this phrase a lot. And you're gonna hear the phrase a certain kind of life called resurrection. I'm going to get into both of those. And they're going to be building blocks along this thing, because if you don't really see this flow that comes out from God and comes out from the Word, and he sets it in order so that we can embrace him in a manner that he wants to be related to, you know, then we're in danger of worshiping idols. You say, oh, no, that wouldn't be the case. I'm pretty sure John in like 1 John said something like, you know, little children, keep yourself from idols. What? You know, we go, oh, I guess back then they were still, you know, carving. You know, he's talking to us. That's for all generations. And maybe they did carve wood or stone back then, and it was it. We carve it out in our minds. There is no faith except it looked to the cross. The cross is the faith by which means we are justified. It is the faith by which we're born again. It is the faith by which we, everything, your healing, anything and everything. You know, for years, I'm on these videos drinking Coke. Y'all know that, right? I mean, I must have drank a million Cokes. It's sad, in my old age, I'm found drinking juice boxes with smiley faces. This is what's become a Brandy Nussbaum. Oh boy, you talk about backsliding. All right. Therefore, when we say we have faith, we are saying that we believe. Listen to this carefully. Therefore, when we say we have faith, we are saying that we believe God's belief concerning the cross. We're saying we believe what God believes concerning the cross instead of what we believe about it. Oh, he died for my sins so that this flesh vehicle, this vehicle that carries loads of flesh and wipes it like a slimy leper on everybody it touches, is saved because I believe Jesus died for me. Hello? And Jesus would say, I didn't die for you to exist. I died so you wouldn't exist. Therefore, Therefore, when we say we have faith, we're saying we believe we believe God's beliefs concerning the cross. When you first came to believe, you believed in death as seen at the cross, right? Didn't everybody get saved over the cross? Didn't everybody go, you know what? I can't believe Jesus died for me when I didn't deserve it, and you know, took care of all of this stuff. I don't know about everybody else. That moved the heck out of me. That so impacted me. What? Not just that my sins are gone, but that he who didn't deserve to die would do that for somebody who completely should have been destroyed. So, my belief, my faith is in death as seen at the cross and the God that was crucified. I believe in the crucified God. Crucified God? I believe in the crucified God. I do. I so completely believe in the crucified God. This kind of faith, wow, that was a jump. This kind of faith finds its identity in the cross, but spreads to be the eventual way that the Christian lives. Okay, so there's an identification, there's a belief that this selfless one would do that and did do that for me. But then that belief begins to affect me, to cause an identification. And if it doesn't cause an identification, then we're just believing at something. We're not believing into something. So that identification is going to move me. The identification itself is not valid. I'm identifying with Jesus at the cross. That's not valid enough. The identification must be that I'm starting to identify with my oneness into him, and this is what I'm looking at, though I be far from it. That's what I am. I'm identified with him, not just identified, quote unquote, in his death long enough to get what I need, and now I'm free. I'm free. I'm free. You know, like some jackass who's been let loose from being tied up for years. What you know, running around. You know, and going crazy, saying I'm free. I'm free. No, you're not. I'm sorry. You're a jackass. That's what you are. Well, I'm a free one. Yes, you are. You know, I haven't been getting little notifications of who's on Skype, and it's probably a good idea if I do, because maybe, I might glance down and go, maybe I shouldn't say that. Nah, never mind. Never mind. That's not going to work. All right. So, this kind of faith finds its identity in the cross, but spreads to be the eventual way that the Christian lives. The just, the justified. Come on, who are we talking about that this is going to affect? The justified, the just, shall live by this same faith. All right. Now, I'm not sure if this is, let me just read it. This can be seen from Galatians 2:20, where we see that faith is tightly connected with crucifixion with Christ. Okay, so let's quote it. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, Christ liveth in me. and the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and he gave himself for me. I am crucified with Christ. Anybody see a flow there? Galatians 2:20 is like an eternal circle. If you really look at it, it's an eternal circle. He starts with himself because he's been affected. The just is going to live by faith. But he gives you the basis of it, which brings you right back around to what's affecting him. So the first part is, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but it's not me. It's Christ within me. And along with that, the life that I live in the flesh now is all related to this way. But he doesn't say the life I live in the flesh is a crucified life. It is, because he just described, I am crucified, nevertheless I live, but not I. But he doesn't say it like that. He says, the life I live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. The faith of the Son of God, not faith or Christian faith, but the faith of the Son of God, which would be based on what? What would his faith be? What would he... The faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me so that I could live, so that in my living I could not live but let him live, just like he didn't live to let me live, so that I can die and let him live. You see the eternality of this circle. See, that's, you know, I mean, I got a ring here. It's got a crown of thorns around it. You wouldn't even notice it, but in the smallest, tiniest letter is the whole verse of Galatians 2:20. The whole verse, not just the whole verse. And I'm reading, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live in Christ living in me, and life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I gave himself for me, now I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, and I went, I'm married to Jesus. You know, it's like, yes, that's the one I want. That's what I want to be joined to. That's what I want to be eternally joined to. And I want to be written into his death and his life and my death and my life into his death. And you see that? You see that? It's an incredible verse that won't let you go. It swallows everything. It just swallows it all up. And what's sitting on top of it is a crown of thorns. The king ruling. The Messiah. The one that came to save us. Hallelujah. I could just cry right now. I don't know for joy or what, but I just so much love the Lord. And I just, All right. Hebrews 11 glorifies the kind of faith that God wants and expects. Now, you know, the last time I taught the book of Hebrews, I think it was the last time, when we got to Hebrews 11, I gave an extensive study on Hebrews 11 and how every one of the actions that were in Hebrews 11 were related to faith. You may not see it at first, but you will, yes. Really? Okay, well, she's saying it's in the last class I taught on faith. Which is a great one to teach it in, because that's the faith. That's the faith chapter. So, I said to my wife the other day, I'm genius level stupid. Remember when I said that? I'm genius level stupid. And she went, does that mean you're stupid or you're smart? I said, I'm not one of the dumbest stupid people. I'm pretty smart. for a stupid guy. For a stupid guy. All right. All right, now we want to talk about the right kind of death. We want to get into it a little more. Now, we'll be bobbing in and out of this one, punching it for as we go along so that we can maintain it. So remember, I asked you to remember this little phrase, and from our classes, you should be able to find it, to look for it, to discover it as you go. The right kind of death. Because everybody says, especially around here, life comes out of death. But it's just absolutely not true in general. Life doesn't come out of any death. You know, if you don't believe that, go out in the yard and kill a frog and see. Yeah, there you go. Well, see, now I said a frog, but meow. Malicious, Mallory said, just kill yourself and find out. Mallory said. All right, here we go, the right kind of death. In God's economy, just the fact that a proper and acceptable death took place is the assurance of the reality of resurrection. Shall I read it again? In God's economy, and I'll explain God's economy a little bit more somewhere down. In God's economy, meaning in God's way of dealing and functioning, in God's economy, just the fact that a proper and acceptable death took place, and the next two words are capitalized, is the assurance of the reality of resurrection. We're going to deal extensively in this area, and both with this and with the resurrection, because there is so much wrong concepts and bad idols that don't follow. I'm not accusing here. I'm just saying let's know the Lord. And there are some really wonderful, I mean wonderful, I have been bathing in them for you know, a long time now, and just going, oh, the way you said that, Holy Spirit, it's got their spirit and life, you know what I mean? Now that's spirit and life. Yeah. I'll eat the word. I'll eat it, not just teach it. That's why I got these big bite holes in all these pages. Okay, in 1 Corinthians 15, 3 through 6, let's turn there. You should be still in Romans 10 from last class, but anyway. 1 Corinthians 15, and 1 Corinthians 15, the early part, it's just stating the facts, ma'am. Just the facts, ma'am. Okay? We're going to read verse 3 through 6. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died. Excuse me, but the Holy Spirit just jumped in for a second on something just a little bit off from that. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. Do you remember Paul saying that about communion? For I'm telling you that which I also received, that Jesus took bread and he served, da-da-da-da. And the Spirit just jumped on me when I read that, and he said, Paul only shares what he received. He has no ideas of his own anymore. He was a Pharisee. He was so smart. He was so together. He was so this, and he's so knowledgeable. He was so prideful. He was so himself. He was so, you know, all of this kind of stuff. And now he's so dedicated to the Lord and not being what he was. Not just having Jesus, but making sure I'm telling you what I received, not what I came up with or my genius of having this. This isn't about me. This is about him, and I'm only telling you what I received. And you can receive it too. Praise God. Because if any, you know, I mean, just think of the man. I mean, he was, you know, outpacing all of his brethren in the Jews' religion, he said. Working his way up the ladder. He's riding along and he meets Jesus and he has one brief encounter with Jesus, and the light is so powerful that it blinds him to everything he was before, blinds him to the world, to the earth, to faces, to this, to that. And it starts him on a road of becoming Paul, not Saul of Tarsus. And what does the name Paul mean? Small. You know? Everything he did in the Jewish religion was to become big. And now he just wants to be Paul. I just want to be Paul. I don't want to know anything special. I don't want to be above anyone else. I'm only sharing with you that which I received. So don't, you know, and like Peter, why look ye upon us as if by our own holiness this has been done? It's not us. It's not us. We're just vessels. We're earthen vessels. We're not even glorious jeweled vessels. You know, well, I am. Well, you know, well, good luck with that. Because the Lord will pluck them little suckers right out of you. Then you look like a pimply old vessel. So stop the pride flood, back off, go to the cross, and get hold of Jesus. I share what I have received. Great stuff, Holy Spirit. You're just... Amen. I thought that when that was... Whoever said that, Deb or somebody, yeah, that when you talked about the prosperity gospel, and I was, you know, I mean, I was with Kenneth Copeland and them, and one of the big ones was that one, you know, that you are the head and not the tail. You are the, you know... And the scriptures say that of Israel and everything else, you know. And I thought, you know, that is just so wrong now after the resurrection and after the cross. And I thought the exact same thing. Praise God, we're the tail and not the head. He's the head. It says the scriptures say he's the head. Well, I'm the head. No, you're not. I mean, I can think of what part of the body you are. If you'd like for me to identify that. What are y'all thinking I'm talking about? What? What kind of mind? Yeah, the tail. Oh. Yeah. Yeah, there you go. Woo-hoo. And so it continues. One of the things about new creation is when we get on something, it's hard for us to let out. We will really ride that baby to the end. Okay, excuse me. I was reading scripture here and y'all interrupted. For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12, and after that he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present time, but some have fallen asleep. We'll just stop right there. In my sentence here, I said, in 1 Corinthians 15, 3 through 6, the facts are stated clearly that he died and was buried. The apostle concludes that since it was a God-ordained and acceptable death, then the natural end result would be that Jesus was raised. All right. I know this is early, but I'm going to tell you, the Lord is in that place right there. The Lord, I'm telling you. I'm telling you that seriously, there is a depth that you need to grasp in this. And again, we're early in some of this, but I'm just telling you, this was the first breath. When I read it, it wasn't just reading. It was the first breath of the Holy Spirit to begin to impart something that will genuinely affect you and give you assurance and so many other things. So the apostle concludes that since it was a God-ordained and acceptable death, then the natural end result would be that Jesus was raised. That if there is the right kind of death, there will be a resurrection. Absolutely. All right. So we're not talking in general of death and resurrection. We're not talking, you know, we're talking specifically in the economy of God, the known reality of God, that God would say, according to the way I think and the way that I am, I honor this kind of death, and resurrection will happen. It's a big deal. I mean, you can bank on that. And it'll give you assurance. But I got news for you. If your death isn't the right kind of death, you know, if you're quote unquote dying, laying down your life just to be seen of other people so that they'll think that you're spiritual, you know, all that junk, there's no life going to come out of that. There's no resurrection. There's only pride and self. And when that goes into death, it stays down. It does. Okay. So what Romans is going to do, Romans, from this point on, particularly once we get past 10, and we already said that 11 is going to be covered in that book if you want to look it up. So our next jump will be to 12. Well, we already said 11 was covered in that book. And it is that if you look that up, you don't need me to reteach it and take up half the course and never get to anything else. Put it together. Build together. Don't just let every class be the deal. And the book that I'm talking about is the same one that all the stuff in chapter 9 is there. All you got to do is find it and go, okay, oh, so that's what he meant. And then, yeah, it's the God who hides himself. Yeah. All right. But once we jump into 12 on, forget it. That's what this is. In practical terms. All right? It's going to be this kind of death that brings forth life. All right. So, of course, the comfort is that if you are raised, then you also appear, which was used several times in the scriptures that are here and also used over in Colossians. And it doesn't say you're raised, like Colossians 3, you know, if you be dead with Christ, then, you know, seek those things which are above. And it goes into, then, when he appears, you shall appear also. But when he appears is the resurrection. When you appear is just as a member of him. It's the difference of appearing. The only reason why you, see, you can't die a selfless death. That's why you need the life of Christ. That's why you need oneness. That's why you need to be joined. That's why you need to see him as the resurrection and not try to get him to resurrect what can't come out because it's too selfish. Does that make sense? I mean, it's true. It's true. It's true. It's true. It's true. You know, somebody says, well, you just make us dead and da-da-da-da. I said, I think I'm trying to make Jesus everything. Is that offending you? Yeah, you know, I mean, I am. I'm trying to make Jesus everything. We'll go, well, don't make Jesus everything. Really, you don't want that? That offends you? You know, yeah, but you're making him so big that it overshadows me. Yeah. All right. All right, so our next subtopic is the perfect time for the cross. All right. The perfect time for the cross. Sorry for those who are listening. Was writing on the chalkboard. Our next little building block, the first one is just faith in general. We don't know what that is. The rest of the building blocks are building the reality of faith. It is a faith in the God of the cross. Not just a faith in the cross, yes, but it must be the God of the cross, all right? So then the second building block is the end. The end. The perfect time for the cross is the subtitle. According to Galatians 4, 4 through 6, Jesus came in the fullness of time, right? Are y'all familiar with that scripture? Jesus came in the fullness of time. We assume that it was a perfect time, as if Jesus' coming was ruled by some indiscriminate time outside of himself to which he must obey and come. You know, it's almost like, see, you ask somebody, you say, well, I remember back in 1988, some guy put out a book that said the Lord is coming, and I don't remember the
88 Reasons Why Jesus is Coming in 1988.
Oh, was that what it was? 88 Reasons Why Jesus is Coming in 1988. And, you know, and I would see people read that little book and they would go, well, you know, they're talking to the book, you don't know what time, no man knoweth the time of the hour, you don't know what time. Well, people kind of do that with God too. It's almost like, well, he doesn't know the time. I've heard that, you know, it's kind of like, you know, nobody knows that something's going to sneak up on God, and he's going to go, oh, well, maybe we should do that now, you know, as if there's something outside of himself that is dictating. Can I get amen? Like there's something outside of him, that means that there's something greater that he adheres to. Okay. So, that's why I said, we assume that it was at a perfect time, as if Jesus' coming was ruled by some indiscriminate time outside of himself to which he must obey and come. But it is referred to as the fullness of time or the perfect time because it was the time of the fulfillment. It's a time when everything was fulfilled. The cross fulfilled it all, folks. It was the time of the cross. All the prophets pointed forward to the last days, right? Last days. The cross would be the end and the beginning according to God's reckoning. Again, we see the significance of Christ and the coming of Christ in conjunction with the cross. In other words, the cross was the end. It was the end of you. You might just now be discovering that you're crucified with Christ and you're dead. But guess what? That didn't just happen the day you figured it out. That's been the case since the cross. The cross was the end. It's the end time. That's the end of everything. It all, you know, all that other stuff. But it also was the beginning. Because he's the beginning and the end. Okay? So it was the beginning of all that is now in him. It's called a new creation. And the old creation, as understood and as lived, is now gone. We no longer know him after the flesh. We no longer know one another after the flesh. We know one another in Christ. We know one another in the new beginning, in the new creation. We don't know those, we don't know them anymore after the flesh or in that manner, because the cross was the end of that. You say, but it's still going on, and da 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 da, da 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 da. Not in the heart of God. Where do you live? I mean, really, in His reality, and His reality is, by the way, the only one that counts, right? You know, so you can believe all you want, and you can think all you want, and you can get all mixed up in it, and you go, I'm confused, and how am I supposed to have faith if this is, you know, supposed to be gone, but it ain't gone, and am I supposed to make believe, and da 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 da, and He's going, just shut up, you know. No, He wouldn't. He would never do that. He's much too kind. Or actually, He's done it to me before. When I was in prayer, when He went, stop. Just stop. He did. And I was wrong. And He was right. And I said, yes, sir. But He did. You know? But He knew He could tell me that. And I would go, you know, come to think of it. Okay, I'm with you. Yes, Father. Anyway. So, to believe in the cross can't be to believe in what Jesus has added to our old creation life. Because it was the end time. It was the end of all of that. It cannot be. It's not even possible. You know, what did he say? What did Paul say over in Romans? How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer in it? How shall we continue in grace? How is it possible that we can continue in grace and let sin abound? Okay, well, basically what he's saying is, how can you allow the old sin nature that is dead still rule in the new creation? It's not possible. And you know what? In the actual Greek there, which I know some of y'all up in Arkansas got enough of that little phrase, but nonetheless, in the actual Greek there, it is, the word how is it possible? How is it possible? We read it and says, how can you live on, you go, it's easy, I'm a bad person. I can tell you how. It's what I do. That's right. That's right. So, you know, Paul, just check my list. But thank God he said, how is it possible if you're dead, and not just you, but if all of that is dead, and now there's a new creation, and if any man be in Christ, old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new, and all things are of God. Well, I remember reading that when I was in Bible school and going, no, it ain't. That was my response. I read it, no. Or actually, somebody was teaching in class. I went, old things are passed away, and now all things are become new, and all things are of God. And I said, no, they ain't. I can tell you, follow me around for about a week. You'll see they're not. No, I'm not refuting God. I'm just saying, you know, let's be real. And, you know, God's saying you need to be real with my reality. Okay? But you have to live there, folks. You can't believe in it and then just, you know. I remember I was walking Rocky a couple of days ago, and I wish I'd written it down. I guess I didn't. But it was, how can we say we worship the God on the throne when in our lives we dethrone Him constantly? You know? I mean, that really affected me, because in truth, in a certain sense, it's, He's not on that throne, not the one where we're worshiping, because we've dethroned Him in all the important places. But we want to be able to raise our hands and, you know what I mean, and say, I'm worshiping the God on the throne. No, you're not. He's not there on your throne. You took Him off. Oh, I forgot to put him back up there for worship. You know, here. Now, you know, no, you can't worship him as king on that throne if your walk is dethroning him constantly in your life situation. You can't, because he's not there. It's just a religious desire in your heart at the moment to join in to worship. Well, didn't they continue after the Ark of the Covenant was taken by the Philistines and carried away and there was no one in the Holy of Holies, didn't they all continue to worship the God that wasn't there? Yeah, the God that wasn't there. I worship the God that isn't here. What God do you worship? The God who isn't here. <You know? laughs> They say, why would you do that? I say, well, it's real easy because, you know, there's no requirements. there's no boss. There's nobody on the throne. I'm on the throne. It's perfect for me. You know, religious freedom, America. Haven't you ever heard of that? Okay, I need to finish this so you poor people, so I can get you poor people out of here. You've suffered enough. See, y'all are the ones who prayed that I'd come back and preach this. Oh, okay. I thought you were going to go, I desperately believe that. All right. Wait a minute, let's see. Okay, it was the time of the fulfillment. It was the time of the cross. All the prophets pointed forward to the last days. The cross would be the end and the beginning according to God's reckoning. Again, we see the significance of Christ and the coming of Christ in conjunction with the cross. The coming of Christ in conjunction with the cross. And we're going to deal with this more. We're going to really lay this out even more. And God willing, it'll be even more like slicing it a lot thinner as we get to it. But the coming of Christ, the perfect example is Philippians 2. And when it begins to talk in verse 5, and it begins to speak of Jesus in two different ways. It speaks of him in his incarnation, and it speaks of him in relationship to the cross. But his coming in incarnation, it is not, and it does not address anything about him being a kid or the ministry that he did or this or that. It was that he became as a man, and then as a man, he humbled himself, and then from humbling, he became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And it means his coming was he was born to die. Okay, let's say it a little different. He was born to give himself. Okay, let's say it a little different. He eternally was one who gave himself, and he became incarnated to manifest that at the cross. About that. All right. So, Lord willing, let me see if I can do a little reminder here, because after these classes, I'm so confused to being around y'all. Just teasing. I love you guys. I don't know how y'all put up with me, honestly, because I have a hard time putting up with me. Okay, there's my little marker. All right, the next class then, we'll be talking about what is the initial faith that justifies. What is the initial faith that justifies? And Romans is all about faith that justifies. So we have to find out, because if our definition of being justified is simply that we're forgiven of our sins, then we've missed the greater import of God's heart in relation to the cross. He had it for other reasons, and we only got that much out of it. All right, let's pray. Lord, we just thank you so much that you are our head, our husband, our life, our all. we just want to give back, like Galatians 2. We just want to give back to you. You died so we could live. Now we want to die so you can live, but live in us. We want to see your faith, Jesus. We want to see really where faith came from in the first place, that it wasn't a temporal thing. It wasn't a Greek concept. It wasn't some thing like that. We want what you believe and what you hold as dear, not just that you believe in your heart, but what you are in your heart. We want that to guide our existence, our walk. We want to live by faith, that faith, the way it affected Paul, the way it birthed Galatians 2:20. Didn't just write it, it birthed it. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh my God, my God. Not just speaking in some scribe writing, but your realities birthing scriptures so that we may live and feast on them and love them, because they speak of you and your ways and your nature and the beauty of who you are. Lord, your scripture says, kiss the Son lest he be angry. He's expecting us to love him, to kiss him. We just embrace you, we love you, we kiss you, Jesus. We long after you. We keep our heart fixed. And we press on together. We press on together. That we might have one heart, one gospel, one Father. All of it, Father, based in you, based in God. So, Lord, bless those that are in Ireland as they go to minister. And bless us here with your word as it flows forth. May all of us together, because of oneness, be conformed to your image, Jesus. In your name, amen. All right.